Okay, we are going to do the tutorial on remote collaboration in AR now. The goal of this workshop will be to create a shared application with some basic sharing techniques and tools in place that you can then use to create more complex applications. After that, I will do a slightly different tutorial this time around compared to the one that is in the book, mainly because the one in the book is quite complex, and so this is a sort of reduced version from the single player perspective, but it contains all the sharing functionality as well, and it also gives you another look into the topic, so that you have two different projects that you can try out, one in the book and one that we have now. Okay, so we will create a Earth you can then use to create pins and mark locations on the Earth, basically. So what we will share is essentially the Earth's position and rotation, so that a user will be able to move that one around in mixed reality. And by tapping on the surface, they can create pins, which are then also synchronized. And by tapping on the pins, they can change the pin's color, which is then also synchronized across different devices. For required software, we of course need Unity. I will use Unity 2019.4. I think it will also work 2018.4 if you have that installed. We will use the mixed reality toolkit. I will show you briefly how we can integrate that one. So this is a open source library by Microsoft for creating HoloLens applications, for example, but also other mixed reality applications for other devices. And finally, I will show you how to integrate the Photon library, which is this networking library that essentially runs all of the networking and synchronization logic in the background. So we are using that API to synchronize the content that we are showing. So for the milestones, we will go over the project setup that we will have. Then we will create a Photon app ID that we can then use to connect to the Photon servers, authorize the app, and then synchronize everything. We will set up the Earth visuals, then create a room system with Photon that we can join different sessions in Photon. We'll then synchronize with different sort of methods. So one of them is observables. Then we'll instantiate objects in the scene, like these pins, for example, and show how these can then also be synchronized. And we will also go into messaging using remote procedure calls to synchronize something like user input, for example. So for the project setup, we will start by importing the mixed reality toolkit. We will essentially follow the instructions that are on this given link here. So one new option with the latest release of the Mixed Reality Toolkit is that you are able to import it via Unity's Package Manager. So this is a really quick way of doing that. And I will also demonstrate you how to do that. We start by opening Unity. I have the Unity Hub installed. If you only have one version installed, that's also okay. You can simply create a new project here. I will use, as I said, 2019.4. I'll just call the project Virtual Earth. Choose the 3D template, since we're creating a normal 3D application, and then quit create. This will now take a while to do that. While that's happening, we can already look at the mixed reality toolkit integration. So the way that this new version now works is that we have a manifest file which can import packages that you essentially choose from a list, and every package that you write in there will automatically be downloaded and imported into Unity. So one thing that is important for the mixed reality toolkit is that it's not available with the usual packages where Unity looks up the sources, but instead we need to add this scoped registries entry, which will then edit as a own source, for example. So I will show you this in a minute when Unity has finished creating the project, how we can do that. And once we have that inserted, there is a list that we can write with dependencies, and then there we will put in these three packages. Yeah, so this this package import is rather convenient in comparison to the original method that you might know, which is the method to create to download an entire Unity package, which is a sort of zipped version of everything and then import it. So here we only need to create the manifest ones. So what I will do to get quickly to the folder where the project was created is that I right click on this asset browser and then go to show in Explorer. This will open the Explorer view with the package location. And here on this root level of the project, we have this assets folder and we also have this packages folder. And I will go to this packages folder and in there we have a manifest.json. So I can open that in any standard text editor. Here it's choosing Visual Studio for me. Yes, so I will now go back to here and copy this part here. So this is essentially one array. So it has the square brackets around it. I don't need that one because that one is already in the JSON format. This is this curly bracket up here. And I will just insert a new line, paste everything in. And now it's already fitting into the structure of the JSON. Then I will go back and copy these parts that are down here. So this dependency key, we already have that one, so I don't need to copy that. I can simply just take these three lines, copy them, put them in here. And now we have the mixed reality toolkit. And if I now go back to Unity, it will resolve these packages for us and download everything so that we have the mixed reality toolkit available. Okay, so it has imported. I'm sure it will still import for some people, but I will slowly go on. It's not that complex, the next steps, so you can quickly catch up with them while I'm talking. So now, once you've done that, the mixed reality toolkit will open this project configurator window here. It will essentially apply some settings for mixed reality development that you can simply just pass, and it will set everything up. So it, for example, works on a HoloLens or VR devices. So you simply click apply in this pop-up window and make sure that everything that is checkable here is checked. And now we have the settings applied. Yes, so the next step would be to download the supplementary packages. I can also already show that part. So if we go back to the presentation, you see we have some supplementary material that I prepared for you. You can download it at this link. It's essentially the Unity package version, so this sort of zip file that you can then download, save it somewhere on your hard drive. Then we go back to Unity. In the assets folder, you right click, select import package, custom package. So this is essentially the old way of importing the mixed reality toolkit. We're now doing that for the supplementary material. Then you navigate to where you have created these and you import the package. It will then show you this import file here, which where you simply select everything that is selectable and click import. It will create you a new folder, Virtual Earth Supplementary Material. What it contains is I have one created a sphere here, which is not the usual Unity sphere, but is a special one which has textures mapped onto it. So once we apply textures to it, they appear in the right order and don't have seams, for example. So it was simply created in Blender. And then it also has some textures, which I downloaded from NASA. They are open domain, so everyone can use them. So this is essentially a image of a satellite image of the Earth that we can then use to create the Earth's visuals. And we have a cloud texture that we can overlay to create the clouds. So sort of a cloud layer. The next step would be to set up the scenes. So what I will just do is we need a main scene. So I will just take the sample scene that it creates automatically. Rename it to main scene. It will then automatically load this one in here as well. Next step would be to add the mixed reality content. So that we have, for example, the camera controls. To do that, you go to this top menu, mixed reality toolkit, and click on add to scene and configure. Once you do that, it will add this mixed reality toolkit object, which contains all the settings for the mixed reality toolkit. We don't need to touch that at all, I think, at the moment. And we have this mixed reality play space, which essentially contains the camera and everything for tracking, for example. Yeah, so this is essentially the setup for the scene. Now let's create the Earth. So let's go back to the slides for that. So we will create the Earth in this format here. So we will create the sphere 3D model and duplicate it so that we have three instances of it. These instances will be slightly bigger than each other so that we have three layers on top of each other. One of them contains this Earth texture, one of them is this cloud layer above it. And finally, we have an atmosphere material, which will then in composition create a nice visual for us. We will then also add a collider to this object and to make sure that we can actually touch it using the gaze control, for example, or the pointers. And finally, we will add an object manipulator from the mixed reality toolkit, which allows us to move the Earth around. So it's essentially giving us the controls to drag and drop the Earth anywhere we want in a 3D space. So let's start with that part. So this is quite straightforward. We create an empty game object. So right click in this hierarchy view, create empty. You can give it a name by clicking up here, for example. I would just name this one Earth, like that. Then we can also set the position to 0. I think it is already. Good. Next step is to import the Earth sphere. So we go to the supplementary material 3D models. You find this Earth sphere. You drag and drop it into the hierarchy, and I already drop it onto this Earth game object so that it becomes a child object of that. So now we have this sphere in the scene. Make sure that the position is also set to 0 here so that it's in the complete center of this parent object. Now we create the material for that part. So this will be the satellite texture on there. So we get the base color. To do that, I like to create new folders for everything, for every type of asset that we have. So I create a folder materials. Then right click, create material. You will get a new material this way. I will call this one Earth. And now you get this editor on the right side where you can change the settings. So first thing that we do is we change the shader. So usually Unity uses this standard shader. We don't want to use that one because it's quite performance hungry. And for example, on the HoloLens, you don't get good frame rates if you use that one constantly. So the best way to go is to go to the mixed reality toolkit section. So simply select that one here, the one with the spaces in between everything, and select the standard shader. from that. So this is not the Unity standard shader now, but it's the standard shader that is provided by the Mixed Reality Toolkit. It's a bit faster, it's not as physically accurate, but it's good enough for here. So next step would then be to apply the texture. To do that, we go back to the supplementary materials, textures, and have this Earth albedo here. We can simply drag and drop this one onto the sphere, and it will apply it so that we get our first instance of the Earth. Yes, so one thing that we could do is rotate this by minus 90 degrees. So I'm selecting this Earth sphere, the child object, and now typing in minus 90 here. This way the Earth will face the camera. And one other thing that we could do actually is go to the parent object, set the position in the Z direction to 2. And this way, it will always be 2 meters ahead of us. So the camera will start into this direction and we will directly see the Earth, and it's not starting inside of the camera when we start the application. Okay, so now we have the Earth visuals. Now it's time to create the atmosphere, for example. To do that, I will take this Earth sphere object, I will duplicate it. To do that, I press Ctrl D, or you can also right click and select duplicate. This will give you a second one here. I will rename this one to atmosphere. Since it's now completely on top of the other one and at the exact position, we need to change the scale a bit. So I would just put in something like 1.01 for it so that it's slightly larger than the other one and so it appears on top of it. And then we will create a new material for that one. So we go back to materials, right click, create material. I'll call this one atmosphere as well. Same procedure again, so we change this shader from standard to mixed reality standard. Yeah, and now we need to create this nice effect for the atmosphere that essentially means, if we go back to the images that we have, you see that atmosphere essentially means that if you look from it in a 90 degree angle, you basically have a transparent version of it. And if you have the sides here, it will turn slightly blue. So we need to have a rim around it, which turns blue. The way we create this in the materials is we set it here to transparent, like that. It will give us a warning that we can just fix by clicking fix now, and then saying yes. It will somehow change these settings, but we don't need to worry about them here. We will need to set the albedo to something a bit more gray so that it's a bit more showing up. After that, also set, by the way, the alpha to 0 so that it gets completely transparent. And the next step is to at the reflections and the rim. So we go down here to the rendering options. There is a option reflections here that needs to be checked. And the important thing that now gets this atmosphere effect is this rim light. So the mixed reality standard shader has this option here. If we just check it, we can set a color. So we will go for some quite strong blue here. Like that. Also, we need to disable the hover light. So this one down here, since this one is essentially for when you have a cursor that is on top of the object, it will light the object. So we remove that part. And for the Vim light, we actually can update the power parameter, and you can already see that now we get this bluish sort of Vim around it. So something like 2.35 is okay, I think. And actually, let's turn this one down so that we get the correct one. I will then also apply the material to the atmosphere object. The best way to do this, since they are both now on top of each other, is to take this material down here from the assets browser and drag and drop it into the hierarchy onto the object that we want to apply it to. And this way, we now get this. This is what we want. Also still play around with these settings, but I think it should be fairly dark so that we don't get that much reflection in it or that much tint. So something like that. So fairly black, you set the transparency to 0 and you activate the swim light here and set the power to something higher. So now we have this atmosphere. Yeah, so the next thing that we need to do for the visuals is to create this cloud layer. To do that, I will again click on this Earth sphere, duplicate it using Control D. I will rename it. You can, by the way, also do this in the hierarchy by clicking once on this one here, and it will, after some time, go into this renaming one, but you can also do it up here. I will just name it Clouds. The scale should be somehow between the one here. So this one has a scale of 1, this one has a scale of 1.01. So I will just take the middle of that, so 1.005. So it's now essentially in the middle between the other two spheres. And now we will create a new shader for a new material for that one as well. So right click, create material. Clouds. Again, change the shader to mixed reality toolkit standard. Again, also set this one to transparent. Fix this warning. So now we change this alpha here to something like 0 so that it's should be as transparent as possible. Also the albedo needs to be changed so that we go down a bit so that it's not so bright. We also want to disable the hover lights on this one. So we go down here to this hover light option and disable it. So the reason why I'm disabling these on all of them except for the Earth sphere is that they are additive. So if I leave them on everything, the hover lights will be extremely bright because they will overlap each other. And so we will get an extremely bright hover light. So the only material that still has it is the Earth sphere. So we will get a normal hover light this way. Okay, so for the clouds, again, also, we need to set the texture, of course. So to do that, I will go back to the supplementary material, textures. We have this cloud texture in there. You can drag and drop it onto this clouds object here. And we will now get the clouds on here. You can already see. One thing that is now happening is that we cannot see the layer underneath it anymore. To fix that, we can go back to the materials of it and change it so that it's just a second. Oh, I think I didn't apply the material first. So you can apply material first to this one. And after that, you set the texture like this. So what I just did was I went to materials, select this cloud material, drag and drop this one onto the clouds object. And after that, it's now set on here. And now we need to set up the texture for it. For some reason, it's not registered. So what we can just do is we have this material open. We can click on this small dot here, and it will open up this asset view with all the textures that are in the project. And you can immediately see the cloud one. You can select it. And it's now in here. It's not showing up at the moment. The reason for that is that it's, just see. Yes, so the reason for that was this render queue down here. So what you need to do is once you have applied this cloud texture, you go down here to this advanced options. There's a render queue override. So this one was set to -1, which I think is sort of that it's defaulting to something. The reason why it's not working is because it's transparent material. So it assumes that it's somehow on top of something. And we can simply just change the slider here until we get something where it's actually overlaying. So if we turn this too far, we only see the part underneath it. If we turn it not far enough, we only see the clouds itself. So somewhere in between here, around 1,100, is we can see all of them together. So now we have this nice looking Earth. One last step for the Earth would be to create the sphere collider. So to do that, I go back to this parent object, click on it, add components. I search for the sphere collider and add it to this object. And I found that the radius of 0.49 works quite well. So it's now essentially exactly the Earth's radius. And one other thing that we can do is add an object manipulator now. So now we get into this interaction part. You go to add component, type an object manipulator. So this is the component from the mixed reality toolkit that allows you to move things. You don't need to change any of the settings. So we can just use it as it is. If I now start the application, it's going to take the usual couple of seconds for it to work. You can see we can now move around using the mixed reality control, so the simulation mode. To do that, I click the right mouse button and then drag the mouse around so that I can look around. You can move around using the WASD keys, so like it's in a computer game. And you can also move vertically up and down using the Q and the E key, so like that. And if you combine all of that together, you can quite well look around in here. So what we can do now is if you have the cursor on the Earth, so this small ring here in the middle, you can left click and drag the Earth around now. And that is now possible because of the object manipulator script that we have. If you scroll the mouse wheel at the same time, you can also change the depth of this like that. And that is now essentially this part finished. So let's get starting with the actual sharing part. So we will now need to import the Photon library. To do that, let me just go back to the slide. So we need to create an account on Photon's website. Then we'll create a new app ID and import their library from the Unity Asset Store. And then we will set it up using this app ID to start the development process. So if we go there, this is how the website looks like. There's a sign in button at the top right. If you click on that one, you can go to don't have an account, create one. It will ask you for some information and so on. You can fill that out. I will quickly log in with my account. Okay, so you will land on this page and it will have a button dashboard here at the top that you will get to the applications. Okay, so I would resume now. So you have this dashboard button here in the top right. If I click on that one, you have a point here, your applications that I can click on. And once I do, it will get me to the actual dashboard where you can see sort of all created license keys or something like that. So the apps that have been registered here before. So you can see these are actually the tutorial ones from the book and the preparation one for today. But we will create a new one. So to do that, we will go to this button, create a new app, click on it. We will set the type to PhotonPAN. So this is the sort of most basic library that Photon has. All the other ones are sort of more advanced versions. So this bold one, I think, is Vi Performance. The chat is creating a chat tool. The real time is sort of a fairly low level networking stuff, and voice is for creating voice chat. But we are using the normal PAN library that gives us the simple API that is a bit abstracted from the low level stuff. So choose that one. Then we choose a name. So this can be anything you want. I would just put in the same name that I used for the Unity application to make sure that it's matching and that I can find it again. You could, if you wanted to, give it a description. So something like sharing workshop, so that you later remember what this is. And you don't need to give it an URL. And after that, simply hit create. It has now created it down here. You can see it has an app ID here, which is currently cut off. We will use that app ID in a minute. For now, simply keep this browser open with this page. We will return to it in a second. So what we will do is go back to Unity, and now we will import the library. To do that, we need to open the, let's say, the asset store. So we find that one in Unity underneath Window, and then there was the point asset store, or you could also press Control 9 if you want to. So if you click on that one, it will open a new tab here. You might need to log in with your Unity ID, so your account that you use to download and install the Unity. So once you have done that, you can search for Photon. So something like PhotonPAN will probably give you the right results. So let's search for it. There are paid version of it, which are more advanced and so on, but we need this PAN 2.3. So this is the one that we are looking for. So simply click on that one. After that, you have a button here. For you, it will probably see, say, add to my assets, because you have not downloaded it before. I have already downloaded it on another computer and also previously in the past. So for me, it says update because there's a new version that I have not downloaded yet. But simply click on this blue button here. It will then download the version and link it to your account. So once that is done, the button should change and it shall now say import. So what you do is you click again on this import now. And this will now actually download the package and put it into your project. So you will get this window here, which is the same one as importing a Unity package. And simply make sure that everything is selected and then click on import. Okay, so click import to import the package. Okay, so it's now completed the import. What will pop up is this window here, which is for setting up the project. And this one now asks you for your app ID. It says that you can also add your email address here, and it will then automatically look that up. I have not had good experiences with that, so the app ID is what you should put in here. If you by accident click this window away, I will also show you how you can reach that one again, or for example, if you want to change the app ID at a later stage. But for now, let's go back to the dashboard of Photon in your browser. And then you can go to this app ID, click once on it. So it will then select the entire app ID. You can copy it using Control C. Then go back to Unity and simply paste it in. And then click on Setup Project. Okay, after that, you can close this window. If you have accidentally closed this window before entering the app ID, what you can do is to go to Window. There you now have a point Photon Unity Networking, and there is an option Highlight Server Settings. So if you click that one, you will get in this inspector view the entire infos about the Photon configuration. And if you expand the server cloud section, you will find a point at app ID PAN. And you can also put your app ID now in here. One thing that's important to note is if you are working with multiple developers on one project, they all need to use the same app ID. Otherwise, the different clients cannot see each other. And you need to make sure that you're all developing with the same PAN and Photon library version. So if one developer downloads the application, develops a project, and then another developer joins at a later stage and also sets up their own installation of Photon in the project, they need to make sure that they're using the same version here. Otherwise, the two clients will also not see each other. So the app ID is also a way to separate different devices or separate different projects from one another. So even if the entire rest of the project is completely identical, if you put another app ID in here, you will be essentially in a different universe and will not be able to connect to people who have another app ID set up in here. Okay, so this is now set up. This is actually the entire setup of Photon. So we now go into the room system. So the idea of the room system is that we essentially have a client which connects to a server. And the server is structured in a way that you have a lobby where people are waiting. They cannot see each other in the lobby, but they have a list of rooms that are available to them. And then they can either create new rooms or they can join existing rooms if there's still space in them. And this is exactly what we will now program. So let's go back to Unity, go to the scene view again. So this should be up here in these tabs. What I usually do for the room setup is to create different scenes for the state where the client is not connected to room and the scene where the client is in a room. So this main scene that we've just created is actually the one that is available once we are in a room. So what you should do now is save the scene. Then we'll go back to the scenes folder, right click, create new scene, and call this one start scene. Then double click on it to open it. We'll now create this, open this empty scene. What you can do then is again, add the mixed reality toolkit to it, add to scene and configure. Usually in a productive environment, you would create a more sophisticated scene switching system. So the mixed reality toolkit also has some settings in here. For example, the scene system to let you switch between scenes. The thing that is not that nice in this example is that it essentially replaces the mixed reality toolkit once we switch into the other scene. So their usual setup would be that you would make this one persistent, and if you switch the scene, it would still use the original one, because if we change some settings in here, it will be overwritten by the settings that we met in the main scene. But since we are not touching this, it's completely okay for this purpose, and for sake of complexity, I will just use this way. But just as a notice, if you wanted to do more with that, you should look into the scene system. Okay, so what we will do now is create a Vroom launcher script, which will essentially connect us to the server and then join a Vroom. So we need the script to live somewhere. So we right click, create empty. You add a Vroom launcher. So I will just call this one Vroom launcher. And then we will create a script. So go to assets, right click, create folder first of all, since we want to have stuff separated. So next script, then right click, create C# script, and we will just call this one Vroom launcher as well. Open it by double clicking on it. Okay, so we can get rid of this usual templates that we have, so if we just have the class in here. The first thing that we want to do is change this from mono behavior to something called mono behavior pun callbacks. So it's now giving me an error because it doesn't have the namespace for that. So what you can do is simply right click quick actions and refactorings, or you can also, I think, click Alt and Enter to get quickly to that part. It will then suggest to you using Photon Pun. So you can click on that one and it will add it to the namespaces. And now this class is available. So what this essentially does, it is a base implementation that registers to pun callbacks, so that in some events that are happening in the network, it will then call some methods in this version. Yeah, so what we do is in Awake, there is a, the first thing that we do is we want to make sure that we sync the scene switch between all clients. So what we can do is write photon network dot automatically sync scene equals true. And this will make sure that all clients change the scene if necessary. So now for the way how the rest of the script looks. So we have a start method that is executed directly after Awake. So in the first frame when the application exists, we call in there a function connect to server that we still need to write. So create another method, private void connect to server. So this, we could name this one anything really we want to, that is not a special method or anything. So what we want to do is we want to check if we are already connected, then we want to join a Vroom. If we are not connected, then we want to connect. So let's say the first thing we want to do is check in the Photon network if we are connected. That is possible with this is connected. So if we are actually connected, we are already in the lobby, and so we are ready to join a Vroom. So to do that, we can say photon network.join random Vroom. There are different ways of joining rooms. So this is a method that will just pick any room by random that is available, and it will fail if no room is available, but we will handle that case later. And if we are not connected, we want to connect. So what we do is photon network.connect using settings. That was the one I wanted. So this essentially does the connect you, but it uses the settings that you've just set up in the photon highlighted server settings. So for example, it uses your app ID. We'll also do stuff under the hood. For example, look at the different servers that are available in the Photon Cloud, since they are hosting the servers for that. And it will, for example, make sure that we are using the European servers and not the US servers, since they have a, because of the distance, a worse ping. And one thing that is also good practice to do in this case is to go in here and say that we want to have a game version. So we say photonnetwork.gameversion equals game version. So we will create for that a const up here. So let's say private const string game version equal to 1, like that. And now if we do really breaking changes during the development of the application, we can increment that game version, and that will make sure that the game is actually only working for people who have the same networking solution available to them. So if we make breaking changes to our synchronization implementation, we don't want to connect to people, one who has the old implementation, one who has the new implementation. So this game version is a way to separate that. So if they want to join each other, they will not be able to see each other in that case, and will not be able to join the same room, for example. Okay, so this is essentially set up to connect and down here, and this is the one to join. One thing that we are not yet covering is what happens if we first connect and then afterwards we want to join. So this is only done at the moment in start, so it will only try to connect once and then it will not do anything anymore. To get rid of that, there are some callback methods. That's why we inherited from this callbacks method up here. So what we do is we want to override a method called onConnectedToMaster. So this is called in the event that the client is connected to the server now. We can put a debug in here to see once that happens. Like that. And what we also want to do in that case, since we are now know that we are connected, we also want to join a room now. So again, join random room. So this join random room has two outcomes. One of them can be that it failed. So want to handle that case, because that's actually not a edge case, but one that is quite usual and will probably happened the first time around already. The reason for that is that join random room only works if there are already rooms available that a person can join. So the very first person to join our server will not be able to join any room because there are none. And so they will need to create a new one. So we need to handle this case. So this is called once this one has failed. What we can do is again lock this one on join random failed, and we want to create a new room now. To do that, we can say photonnetwork.createRoom. For the room name, if we leave that one empty, so just pass in an empty string, it will automatically create a random ID for that. And that is what we want, because if we put in a name here, it will always try to create the same room. So this is sort of the identifier to distinguish different rooms. And we don't really care about it at the moment. And you can also have some room options. So I can say something like photon real-time room options, add this one in here. In putting in these curly brackets to initialize this new object that I'm creating in here. And for example, I can say that max players should be 2. So there's only allowed to be 2 players in the room at the same time. You could also put this higher. This is completely up to you. And this is essentially the part where the join random failed. So we're creating this room this way now. And the last one that we need is the case where the join room was successful. So what we do is overwrite on joined room. So this gets called every time that we and actually manage to enter a room. And for now, we can just say in here debug.log joined the room. Okay, so this is the connection status. So we can now try that out. Okay, so let's go on with the... So it's now importing the new script that we created. We need to add it. So click on this room launcher that we created, add component and search for the room launcher and add it as a component. You could also just have drag and drop that one over here, that as well, that also works. So one important thing that we need to do is to make sure that we actually switch the scene. So to prepare that part, we need to go open the scenes down here. So we have the start scene, the main scene, then go to file, build settings, and it will give you the build, and all scenes that you need to switch to need to be in this build up here. So to do that, first drag and drop the main, the start scene up here, so that it's now in here with the index 0. After that, do the same thing for the main scene, so drag and drop that one in there. So it should now have the start scene at the top and the main scene at the bottom. The order is important since we want to address them by this number. And this first one is also the one that's always started in the application. So this is now, should now work. One thing that's still missing is we actually need to tell the script that we want to switch a scene once we join the room. To do that, we go back to this onJoined room method and add a new thing in here called scene manager. Again, it's not helping us here because we need to import the main namespace. So again, right click on it, quick actions and refactorings. And then using Unity Engine that scene management, we can choose from that, and now it's available. And we can say that we want to load the scene in here. And this is now where we put in the scene build index. So we want the main scene, which we just defined as scene number one. So the one that's the second one in the list, but it has the index one since we start counting at 0. And this is now enough to switch the scene already. So we can try that out. So make sure that you're now in the start scene, then press play. It will take a couple of seconds. And now we have switched the scene into the main scene and are now in a shared network room. If you look at the console, you can see that these first ones are just some development messages, but we see the order in which we got the logs. So we connected to this master server, then the join random room failed, and it tries to create a new room, and this succeeded then, and we have now joined this new room. So everything is working as we expected to. Perfect. The next step then would be to synchronize objects using observables. So what we are doing here is we will add a component named photon view to an object, and after that we will add a list of observables to it, which will then allow us to synchronize the Earth's position. So we already made it that we can move it around, but now we'll synchronize it in a way that other people can actually see us moving around the Earth. So to do that, we can either use a pre-configured component using Photon Transform View, or we can create our own observables for sending and writing data. And I will also show you a trick how you can test the sharing functionality on one device only. So usually you would say that you need multiple devices to test that, but you can actually do it on one PC simply by duplicating the project files. So let's get started with that part. We need to go again to the main scene because that is where our Earth lives. So there we are. With this Earth object here, I will go down in the inspector and click the Add Component button. I will add a photon view component, which is this one down here. So the simple photon view just. So what this has done is added essentially an identity in the network for this object. So it has now been assigned an ID here. So this one will just count up for everything that we create. So if we create another object with a photon view, this will then have the number 2. We can set some ownership transfer up. That's an advanced topic. So the concept behind that is the person who created this object is the owner of the object and the only one who can actually write data about it and broadcast it to the other devices in the network. We can set this to changed or to takeover and request. If we do that, the ownership can be taken away from somebody, so or they can transfer it to other devices. So that is useful if we have an object that should be movable by multiple people, then we can simply transfer the ownership between them and then they are all able to move and the object and it will update for everyone else. We can also set some synchronization methods here. They are, you can read up on the in the documentation what they do in detail. They have some effects on performance and bandwidth consumption, showing how the data are transmitted. So if they are unreliable, some packages can get lost, and it's not guaranteed that they get in the correct order to the other side. Essentially these are some different methods that we can use. We will just leave it on unreliable on change. And down here, there's an observable search. So what we will do is add some other components in here, which are essentially observables, which then observe some values, which are then synchronized across the network. And we can leave that at auto find all. What that does is it will simply automatically populate this list of observable components for us, so we don't have to manually do that. So the predefined component that we can use from Photon is the Photon transform view. So this one here, if you type in Photon view again, you will find it. Simply add it to as a component in here, and it will give you really simple options. So you can either synchronize the position, rotation, and scale. And what you can also see is that we now have in this observed components part, this component here is set up now. So this one now says photon transform view. So this auto find all worked, and it has now registered this value in there. So this is essentially how you can already now set this up. So now we are coming to the trick how we can actually check if this worked. So what we do is we save the scene first of all to make sure that it's actually written to the files. After that, we go back to our project view and we will copy some files here. Don't copy all of them because that will take a really long time to copy since there are really many in there, but you only need the assets one, packages, and project settings. So these are the three files that are essential to a project. All the other ones can be regenerated by Unity. So simply copy them using Control C. Then I'll go to a higher level in the folder, create a new folder, call this one Virtual Earth 2. Enter that folder and paste everything in using Control V. So now we have the assets, packages, and project settings in here as well. What I will now do is open another Unity instance. And I will now add this project. So click add here. And then you need to search it in your list, just there. And now we have the second instance here. So, and then click on it to open it. So what this essentially does is it circumvents the condition that once you've opened a project in Unity, it's read only for any other Unity. So Unity will not open the same project twice. So you need to copy the entire project to open it again. And this will also automatically copy all your settings for you. So that's really a useful way of working here. The only thing is once you do changes to one of them, you need to synchronize them over to the other side as well. So copy everything again and copy it over again, essentially. You can write a script for that, for example, if you're working on a larger project and you don't want to do that manually all the time. You can, for example, write a bash script for that and then simply run it and it will then copy your things over. That would be an option. Yeah, so we are just waiting for that to import. While that's going on in the background, I can already show you how you can create your own observables. So the one that we just added is a pre-made one, but we can create our own ones, which are then able to synchronize all values essentially that you want to synchronize. To do that, we will go to assets and scripts again, create a new script, which is then called position synchronizer, because we will just use it for the same thing. So open that one. Can delete again the thing that we, the template that we got. The thing now is to create an observable, we need to implement an interface, which is IPAN observable. Again, it's not helping us because the namespace is not there. So let's add the namespace. Now we need to implement the interface, which can be done the same way. So I click on it, quick actions and refactorings, implement interface. So it's now added this one method on Photon serialized view, which gives us a stream and some information about it. We only need the stream. So it's important to know that this method is called exactly every time that you send or receive a message. So it's not distinguishing between these two in methods, but they are essentially the same. So we need to distinguish between that in here. To do that, we have an if statement here where we ask if the stream is, for example, writing. And if it's writing, we want to send a value. And if it's not writing, we want to read from the stream. So to send some value, we can say stream.sendNext. And we can put in some object. So this can now be any value that you want that we can now synchronize. What we want to do here is take the transform's position. So this is now the position of the Earth. If we have attached this one to the Earth. And sort of symmetrical to that, we can now read this by going to stream read, receive next, which will give us a value back from the stream. So it's important to know that this is essentially a queue. So if we add values in here, multiple values, they need to be read in the same order in which they were written in here. This command here is not yet finished because this one returns an object. So what we want to do with that object is actually to write that to the transform's position, something like that. This still gives us an error because we are just getting a generic object back. So we need to still cast that one. Since we know that this is a vector 3, we can just put it in front of that to cast to that. And now the assignment is working. So if you now wanted to also update the rotation, we can do that also by doing the same thing. So stream.sendNext transform.rotation like that. And now it's important that this is also, since we put that one in second in here, it also needs to be read as the second part in here. So this one now needs to be transrotation here as well. This is a quaternion for the rotation, and we receive it from the stream like that. And this is essentially now the a simple way of synchronizing values. So I think the copy has now finished actually, so we can demo that. One thing that we need to do in the second copy, so this on the right here is now my second copy, is the one thing that has not been copied is if you go to build settings. Oh yes, it worked actually. So in my previous attempt, it didn't work that these two were also copied. So make sure that these scenes are actually included in the build. After that, you can go to your to one of them, click the play button. Wait for it to join the room. You need to be in the always need to be in the starting scene to start the application. Otherwise, it's not going to connect to the room properly because that is the one that contains all the logic. So let's go back to the scenes, start scene, and then start that one, and do the same thing also on this side. So we go to scene, start scenes to open that one. Wait for that one here to finish. There it is. And we can now start the second one. I wouldn't recommend starting them at the same time, since you then don't know which one was in the room first, because the one that is longest in the room and essentially now the one that's joined first is going to be the master client, which by default is going to be the owner of this object then. So we now have this object here. So if I now click and move it, you can see the other side is moving as well. So we now are transferring the data between the two options. One thing that you can see with the ownership is this left side is actually controlling the position, but this right side is not able to cast position. So if I move it on the other side, which is not the owner of the object, it can be moved. You can and should probably do something against that in project. So you will either lock the manipulation if you're not the owner, or you should transfer the ownership to this part then. But if I now go back and move this one here, it will immediately update again the position since it's transferred around. Yes, okay, so this is now using the version that's it's actually the pre-configured one. We also created our version that we just implemented. So let's try that one out. So we go to this Earth and we move the photon transform component and add in our position synchronizer like that. And then we need to do the same thing on the other side. So save this project. You can already go back to the start scene here. And then you go to your original project in which you changed something. You only need to copy the assets over folder this time around, since we only worked in that one. Paste it into here. And that will then take some time to do that. Yeah, but this is essentially the workflow. So you want to overwrite everything in there. There are certainly better ways if you have got some synchronization file system that can actually smartly do that. But yeah, that's sort of the brute force method. So now these two are synced up again from the project development point of view. We are now using our own script that we've created. So it's position synchronizer one. We connect again to the room. And now if we move this one, we see we get the same results that it's updating. One thing that you will notice is that with our implementation, it's a bit more choppy. So if I move it around quickly, you will see that it sort of jumps around. The reason for that is that their Photon implementation does somewhat advanced stuff in there, like interpolating between the points so that you get a smooth transition between them. We are just updating the position each time we get a data package. So it's essentially writing data to the other side, and each time we get it, we just assign the position. So there are some more advanced ways of dealing with that, that you don't get this sort of stuttering effect. So we'll go back to the main scene. And what we will now do, create this pin that we can then stick into the Earth. To do that, we create another empty object, which will serve as our parent object for the pin. So we set this one to pin. So it's essentially the same process again. We can add a cylinder as the sort of pin body. We can rotate that one by minus 90 degree on the x-axis so that it's lying in this plane here. Also, scale should be set to something fairly low so that we get this thin pin-like structure. You can double click on an entry in the hierarchy to get there. Exactly. So the other thing is we need to set the position here to 0.03. So it's essentially, oops, didn't take it like that. So it's essentially this value that is in here. This is the length of the pin. We are putting that one into here so that if we go back to the parent object and set the transform position to local, I think it is, and this one to pivot, you can see that the actual pin parent object is located down here. So this is sort of the origin point, and then we have this 3D model on top of it. I will also add some a head for the pin. So to do that, I create a sphere as a child object of this pin object. It will have a scale of 0.02 and a position of 0.06 right here in the Z value. For that, we can also then create some materials. So just quickly create some material here. So we have one, a plastic one for the hat. This one again, set it to mixed reality toolkit standards. Okay, we can give it some value like that. And for the pin body, we can create another material, call this one, for example, metal. Assign it again to this object, then set a shader from mixed reality to mixed reality standard. We can turn on this slider here metallic, which will then make this have a metallic look. We can set it to be smoother than that, for example. That will then give us the pin. One big thing with the instantiate is that you can only instantiate objects which are resources. So Unity has a special folder name called resources. So if you go to somewhere in your assets browser, you can create a folder, name this one resources, like that. It must be exactly written like that. I think also with a capital R. Go into that one. And now we will drag and drop this pin parent object into there. And this has now created a prefab for us. So after that, we can delete this pin object we had in the scene already. And this is essentially the pin. We can also now modify this one by double clicking on it. I think this only works in Unity 2019. In 2018, you would have to have it in the scene and then work on that part. So what we can do in here now is add the photon view. So this will also be a networked object. So we add the photon view like that. It says the view ID will be set at runtime because we don't actually know when it will be added to the scene. We will do that by a script. And then we can enter or can, we can exit this mode again by clicking the small left button here in the top. And now we have this pin here with the photon view set up. What we want to do is we want to be able to click on the Earth to set this pin. So to do that, we go to Earth, add the interactable, which is a script which essentially allows you to interact with any object like a button. It gives you this onClick method. We want to have something that reacts to this onClick. So we create a script for that in here. And let's call it something like pinPlacer. Open that one up. We don't need these parts right here. The only thing that we need is a public method. I can call it any way we like, something like placePin, and this will be called by the interactable to execute some logic when we are interacting with the Earth. So what we want to do in here is write something like photon network. Again, it's not helping us because we need to import the namespace. Dot instantiate. So this is essentially the same thing as the game object instantiate, but this one tells you that it's going to be synchronized across the network. So this is the key message from this part here, that you have to use this version. After that, you will need to put in the string name of the prefab that you created. So in this case, it was called pin. And you can give it a position and rotation. So what I will do is I will use the gaze cursor's position and rotation. To do this, I will use the MRTK service library. So let's see, it's this one here from the my mixed reality toolkit. So this using directive is needed. In.inputSystem.gazeProvider.gazeCursor.position. And then the same thing again for the rotation. But then you will use the rotation, of course. See, like that. And this is essentially the position and rotation of the circular object that you saw on the middle of the screen. So what this will now do is it will let us create a pin that is then transferred to other clients as well. So for the Earth, we go back, we add this pin placer like that. And in the onClick method, we click this plus button here, then we drag and drop this pin component on there, set this from no function to pin placer and then place pin. So if you select that one, it's now going to execute that method in there. And this is essentially all we need to do. So the important thing is the pin needs to be in this resources folder, and we need to call photon network.instantiate and then use this name that is given right here. Let's copy that one over again to the second copy project to test it. Let's see. Yeah, I need to go back to the start scene, of course. Yes, well, start scene. Okay, now if I click somewhere, it places a pin. And you can see in here, it has placed the exact same, at the exact same position, another pin. So let's show that again. So if I click somewhere, you can see the small dot somewhere here. So I will just place it somewhere in the tip of Italy and place it. You will see that it has actually put the pin there as well. So that is how you instantiate objects that are then synchronized across the network. And then quickly for the remote procedure calls. So these are another way of synchronizing things. What you can do in there is essentially manually send messages over. What I will just do for that one is go to the pin and give it an option to change its color. So we create a C# script in the scripts folder, call this one color changer. We can give it some references. So I'm usually using the serialized fields attribute to say that it's an inspector. This way I can also use private variables then. We need a color array. And we need a renderer that we actually want to change the color on. And after that, we want to have a public method change color. Like that. And this one will then set the color. So what we do is target renderer.material.color is set to some color. We need to have an index for that. So let's define an index, something like that. And so we will have color stuff dot index. And of course, we want to switch through these colors. So to do that, we just increment the index. And once we've run out of the bounds of this array, we can say if index is larger than colors dot dot length, I think it needs to be larger or equal to. We can then say that index should be 0 again. So essentially we are switching through all of them and then starting at the top again. So this is then now the local logic, how we do that. This will then be called in the pin. So let's quickly set this part up. So we go back to our pin in the resources folder, double click on it to open its edit view. Add this color changer in here. We can quickly create some colors, for example, something like this. And we set the target renderer to the sphere object since that is the head that we actually want to change. After that, we will now add a interactable here as well. So that we get another click method here that we can then drag and drop this color changer onto. Select the color changer here as well and then change color. So now if we click on it, it will cycle through these colors. Now we need to synchronize the value actually using a RPC method. So what we can do is we can actually send values here. So once this one has been done, we can say that we want to send something. To do that, we need to change this one from mono behavior to mono behavior pun. This one will automatically fetch this photon view that we have in here. So this is now available as a photon view variable in here. And we can say that this one is going to be sending an RPC like that. We need to give it a method name. So something like on color changed. And we can say who is the target of this. So we can set it to all. We can buffer all messages, which is not something that I recommend because then they will stack up on the server and new clients who get into the room will all have to go through all messages that are there. You can all only send to master client. What I will use is others. So it sends to everybody but itself. So it's not actually doing the same thing again for itself. And I will give the index as the parameter. So we don't actually need to synchronize a color. That is much more data than just the index. And since everything is set up in the same way, we can just use the index here. So what we now need to do is have this sort of receiver method. So the one that we've just defined here. So to do that, we create it here. So it's something like public void on color changed. and we give it an index as a parameter like that. In here, we also now set this up. So we have something like this, and we also want to update our local index. So the index that this class is actually administering is now the same one as the one that it received remotely. Then it's setting it up. This is not yet working because we actually need to tell Photon that this is a RPC receiver. So to do that, we add this attribute at the top. So in square brackets, write pan RPC. So this is now picked up by Photon and will now work. So this is now essentially the RPC consists of the sending method here and then the receiving logic in here. So this should now all be set up and work. So let's test it out. Let's copy the project once again. Okay, so this is essentially, we're also almost done. I'm only just showing this this last part now that it's working, but we've actually implemented everything that we needed to. So just this part has now joined the room. This one also. If I now create a pin here and click on it, you can see it changes the colors as we expect. And you can also see on the right side here that it's actually switching there as well. So this is now the RPC that's working in the background to do that. So usually you would use RPCs if you have events that are rarely used, something like user input. So you don't actually want to have a Photon view on here that it's constantly sending data like the one we use for the position, but instead we want to use this this smaller one here that is essentially only using these messages on demand. Yeah, so that concludes the tutorial. So thank you very much for your attention.